Let's get started. Welcome to another week of operating systems. So let's everybody settle in. It's time for the show to begin. Last week and for the past 2 weeks since we started class, we've been talking about processes and the process abstraction. That was sort of maybe not the most natural place to start, but that is where we did start. And we talked a little bit about processes because I think it helps put sort of what some of what the operating system does in context. So today we're going to start a new sort of unit in the class that'll probably run for roughly a month or so, where we're going to talk specifically about a particular hardware resource and the operating system's role in both multiplexing and providing abstractions on top of that resource. And the first resource we're going to talk about starting today is the processor, or the processor cores, right? And that'll take us through, and we're going to sort of start this time at the bottom. We'll talk about some sort of hardware features that allow the operating system to control the system and to control your machine in order to carry out some of its duties. And then we'll sort of work upwards, talking about some abstractions that we use to think about how the CPU works and how processes are allowed to use the CPU. And then finally, sort of at the very end of this particular unit, we'll get up to the sort of top of the stack and we'll talk about some policy decisions that the operating system makes in terms of how to actually use the CPU and divide the CPU between different processes. So this is sort of fun stuff. So this is sort of our first example of a particular hardware resource, and we're going to discuss the operating system's role in abstracting and multiplexing that resource. All right. I promise that I won't have this on the slide for like months and months, but at some point soon, I think now that this beginning of the semester is over, I should have some time to get the slides online, so they'll be available. At that point, I'll just take down the old 421 website entirely, since I think the only function that's really playing right now is the slides and confusing people who are not able to find the correct course website. So, and then one thing I'd like to experiment with this year on the website, and this is something that you'll probably see in the next week or two too, is having some sort of leaderboard so you guys can look and see how far some of your classmates have progressed in finishing the assignments, right? So this will be sort of an opt-out type of thing. So if you don't want your team up there, you'll be able to unclick something and show up as anonymous or something. But I want you guys to get a sense of what other people are doing, and I want to encourage some sort of healthy competition within the class as far as getting through these assignments, right? Because the clock is ticking and you guys have, you know, maybe about a month left, a little bit over a month to do everything through assignment two. So I want people to sort of have a sense of the timeliness of the class. Any questions about processes? So we spent 2 weeks talking about processes and the process portion of the system call interface. Any lingering questions or doubts about processes before we start something new? Yeah. Do processes have to fork? No, they do not. Okay. So two processes are welcome. This is good review. Two processes are any process. I mean, assuming it has the correct permissions, sort of modulo permissions and visibility of the file, two processes can independently open the same file. What's different about the sort of duplicate copies of the file that they can see after they fork? What's the difference between There's an important difference between two processes independently, who may not have any relationship with each other, independently opening the same file and getting a file handle to it, and two processes sharing a file handle after fork. What is the difference? Yeah.
If you had two processes, the offset would be independent.
Right. So if the two processes open the file independently, then they have their own file handle, meaning that the offset and in certain cases, the mode in which the file was opened is not shared. Right, so any reads or writes to that file will not be seen by the other process. Right, after fork, remember that those file handle objects are initially shared, meaning that the writes and reads to the file manipulate the offset, which is visible to both the parent and its child. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay, great, good question though. All right, so remember we talked about processes as a container abstraction. We have one or more threads. That's what we're going to sort of focus on, the CPU and threads, for the next month. Processes also have access to memory. And for the purposes of this class, we'll talk about the other resource being a disk. But of course, processes also have access to things like the network and other types of system resources. Right? These are the ones we're going to focus on in this semester. If you want to learn about networks, take modern networking concepts. And if you want to learn about old networks, you could take antique networking concepts, which is unfortunately not a class that we offer here in the department. All you get to learn about is the modern networks, not your father's networking. All right, so let's talk about the system call interface. So how do we create a new process? What's the system call used to create a new process?
Fork,
right? What about if I want to change a process? I want to replace it entirely with a new image so that it can go off and do something else. Exec, the exec family. How do I exit a running process?
Exit.
Yeah, that's not too hard. And then collecting the exit code of a child process is done using wait, right? That's perfect. All right, so we talked a little bit about this. So what is the, but how would you describe what fork does to the process file table? When I call fork, the child gets a what of my file table? It's a copy, right? Which, and because the file table contains references to those file handle objects, the copy means that after fork, me and my child are sharing those file handle objects. What does exec do to the process file table? I hear disagreement about this. Let's try that again. What does exec do to the process file table? That's a better answer. Nothing, right? Just don't say anything. Exec, at least some forms of exec are allowed to not manipulate the file table, because that allows us to preserve the work we did during fork. We talked about how this was in some way set up to allow IPC between parent and child processes. All right? And then we set up this little shell, which just read stuff from the command line, called fork. If I'm the child, I exec, allowing me to perform some new task. If I'm the parent, I wait for the child to complete. Right? So this is the very, very sort of 5-minute beginnings of bash, right? There's probably a lot more work that people did on bash after this point. This is a very, very rough beginning. Okay, any questions about processes before we surge on? All right. Oh, yeah, James.
What's the answer to that question again, the where's exit?
Oh, right, where's exit on this? There's no exit. Where does exit get called? Who calls exit? The C library calls exit when the main function returns, right? So you don't have to call exit yourself. If you don't, once main returns, the C library will call it for you. All right? Everyone who's been writing C code has been using the C library without really even knowing it, right? Okay. Any other questions? Good question. All right, so we're gonna talk about how the operating system manages the processors, and I wanna focus on when we start talking about hardware, right? Every piece of hardware we look at, whether it's a CPU, whether it's memory banks or the disk, I want to think about a couple of things in the operating system's role in terms of both creating abstractions and multiplexing the resource. So the first thing is, what are some limitations or problems with the hardware resource that the operating system is trying to address? So in the case of the CPU, you know, who can think of a particular limitation of the CPU that the operating system might be trying to address? Yeah. Right, so in general, right, I mean, if you could pretend that, you know, you were, you know, 20 years older than you are and you lived through the days when most people only had single core machines, then it was definitely true that the number of things that you wanted to imagine were going on your computer at the same time was much greater than the number of actual execution units you had in order to get those things to work, right? Now that we have multi-core, it's still probably true, though, right? If you look at your machine and you think about all the stuff that's going on, all 68 of your Firefox tabs and, you know, like the 4 or 5 movies you're playing simultaneously and stuff like that, there's usually probably still more things that appear to be happening concurrently than there are actual execution cores to make those things happen, right? So certainly the number of things that we want the machine to appear to be doing is greater than the number of execution cores we have, right? So there's only one processor, or at least not that many, right? So the next thing we're going to talk about in each one of these things are some of the mechanisms that operating systems have to have in order to allow these resources to be shared, right? Because in most cases, one of the main limitations of these resources is that there's only one of them, there's only so much of it, or whatever. And one of the things the operating system wants to do is multiplex that resource, right? Does anyone remember what multiplex means? Yeah.
Saving the same resource among different processes.
Yeah, I mean, it's just a fancy computer scientist word for sharing, right? You know, it sounds more, you know, plexi, right? Like, you know, sharing resources. Then people think you're like a communications major or something, right? You know, you say multiplexing, they're like, ooh, you know, I'm dealing with an engineer here. So we'll talk for each resource about these mechanisms. And in the case of the CPU, we're going to start talking about this today. This is interrupts and then also context switching, right? So both of these. And in every one of these cases, too, one of the things I want you guys to see, which is really neat, is that there's this really interesting sort of codependence between the operating system mechanisms and hardware, right? Hardware and the operating system have been playing this sort of very intricate dance for years, right? Where the operating system sort of builds abstractions to sort of correct hardware weaknesses, and then hardware sometimes actually even fixes those weaknesses directly, or at least has mechanisms built into it that allow the operating system to help it, right? And we'll talk about some of that codependence as we go through the CPU, right? So one of the other things that I think, again, it's from a sort of educational perspective, I guess what we're doing is all educational, but in terms of you guys understanding how the operating system works for your own lives as programmers, it's also important to understand the consequences of these limited resources and how they're shared, right? So if there really is only one CPU, what does that mean for you as a programmer, right? If there really is only a certain amount of memory, what does that mean for you as a programmer? Because frequently the operating system is trying to provide you the illusion that there's a lot more than there actually is, right? But fundamentally these resources are limited and these things have consequences. With the CPU, the other thing that's fun is one of the consequences is that because of the illusion that the CPU, that the operating system is going to be able to provide, that there are actually multiple things that are going on, you guys as programmers need some new tools to make sure that your code runs safely, right? How many people have done a lot of multi-threaded programming before? Yeah, see, everybody's hand should be up, man. It's the multi-core era, you know? So you guys writing single-threaded programs, I mean, what is your program going to do when it gets onto a smartphone? It's got four cores, right? It's like, oh, man, I can't use those other three cores. Just take them back, you know? So we'll talk about concurrency, so the illusion of concurrency and synchronization, which is really important. And synchronization is going to be something that you guys are going to have to deal with, because no matter how many multi-threaded programs you haven't written in the past, you're writing one this semester, right? You know, the operating system is probably one of the most important and critical and very inherently multi-threaded programs out there, right? And you guys will have to use synchronization primitives correctly to get your assignments to work. And then finally, so you know, so we're sort of popping up the stack here. Once we have mechanisms in place to share resources, and once we've dealt with some of the consequences of those resources being shared, we still have these questions about how should I share resources, right? How should I allocate resources between the people who are competing, or in this case, the processes on the machine that are competing for them, right? And that's, in this case, with the CPU, that's called processor scheduling, right? And we'll get to that in about 3 weeks, right? All right. So. But the place we kind of have to start with to make any forward progress here is this idea of, you know, operating system or kernel privilege, right? And I don't know if you guys remember, but when we started this class to sort of try to demystify operating systems, I reminded you that operating systems at fundamentally are just a what? Just a computer program, right? It's just a bunch of instructions executing on your computer, right? And to a first approximation, that is true, right? And actually, it's true pretty much to many different approximations. But the operating system is a special program, right? And a lot of it being special is involved with it actually being required to manage resources, right? So if there's only a limited amount of something, and you don't want to have, you know, massive, violent, bloody conflict between people who want it, right? One way of allocating it is to elect somebody and give them special powers and put them in charge of that resource, right? As long as, you know, you can trust them to do the right thing. And that's kind of the role that the operating system plays with respect to system resources. What we're going to talk about today is where do those special powers come from and what does that really mean, right? What does it mean for the operating system to be privileged, right? And the funny thing is all the stuff we've talked about up till now, all the process-related system calls, none of that really requires operating system privilege. And if you want to convince yourself of that, go look at the interface to like a threading library, right? How many people have used pthreads before? So the pthreads library ends up looking, providing a lot of these same sort of process-like system calls. And so what's happening here is that it turns out that the operating system doesn't necessarily always take advantage or need the special privilege to implement abstractions, right? And what we've talked about so far is this idea of the process abstraction and the operating system's role in creating, right? But remember going back to our two rules for the operating system, right? The reason that the operating system needs these privileges is multiplexing, right? And you know, essentially, if I don't trust processes on the system, one way to handle that is to take this one special entity, right? And there's two things that multiplexing involves, right? If I have a resource and I want to divide the resource between people who are competing for it, what do I need to do? What's the first step? Yeah.
Prioritize.
Yeah. Well, what does that involve? I mean, a prioritization might be one way of proceeding with a what?
Scheduling.
What's that?
Scheduling.
No, scheduling is another term for this. Yeah.
Yeah,
I got to divide the resources up, right? I got to decide, you know, who's going to get how much pie, right? I've got one pie. I've got 150 of you guys. And I need to have some sort of mechanism, right? So maybe I go to my, you know, ops class leaderboard and I see who's gotten the farthest with the assignments, and that's how I hand out pie, right? That's one effective prioritization. So, but then what's the next thing I need to do? So I can divide up the resources. I can say, okay, here's a piece of pie for you guys. What do I need to do next?
Make sure no one takes more than your pie.
Yeah, like I gotta make sure someone doesn't come up and, like, you know, punch you and take your pie, right? You're like, I don't care, man. I want that. That looks like a good pie. So I need to actually enforce these divisions, right? So and these things are both important, right? And I need to be able to figure out how am I going to divide up the resources, and then once that's done, I need to make sure that people don't stomp all over each other, right? When operating systems don't do this very well, what's sort of the classic way that you notice failures to enforce divisions? What's the sort of mem that's entered our consciousness that happens when operating systems don't do a very good job at enforcing resource division? Yeah.
Blue screen?
Yeah, the blue screen of death, right? Normally comes about because an operating system didn't correctly enforce the division between resources, and two processes were sort of messing with each other, or worse, able to mess with the operating system, right? I mean, it's one thing if I let one process come over and take another process's cake, right? It's another thing if I let one of the processes come and to me and take the cake, right? That's an even bigger problem. So now let me ask you another question. So when operating systems don't divide resources very well, how do you notice that? What's the symptom of poor resource division? Yeah. No, I'm just asking, how can you tell?
Unresponsive processes.
Yeah, the machine's slow, right? And you know, machines can be slow because you've asked it to do too much. That's one problem. But machines can also get slow when the operating system doesn't do a good job of dividing resources properly, right? All right, so why can't I just, you know, so again, this whole regime sounds very dictatorial, right? Like, why have I elected this one process to be in charge, and then I've spent like decades and decades getting it to work well? I should just be able to work this out myself, right? You know, I should just say, here, processes, here's a bunch of memory, go, you guys figure it out, right? Like, figure out how you want to divide the memory. What's the problem with that? Yeah, I mean, you know, processes are not necessarily not self-interested, right? They may want stuff and just sort of take it, right? So I could have processes that are intentionally malicious, but it's actually probably more likely that processes are what?
They cannot communicate.
Well, let's say I invented some fancy communication mechanism. They're just badly written, right? How many people in here have never written bad code? How many people in here commonly write bad code? Okay, good. At least you guys are honest, right? I remember talking with someone once, and he was like, you know, he's a person who does research on programming languages, and he's like, how many people have actually come to you and said, I'm not a very good programmer, right? He said, that's why we need more language support, because everybody thinks they're a good program, right? I mean, I think everyone thinks we're in the top half of the programming class, which that's impossible. So, right, and it turns out, and actually, I don't want to make this sound as completely silly, because it turns out there were early computer operating systems that actually did a lot more forms of cooperative resource allocation. So, for example, I remember a friend of mine in in college who was this, and this was like a fancy thing to do at the time. He was burning DVDs on his computer. He used to go to concerts and tape them live, so he used to burn them onto DVDs so he could send them to other people who were interested in this sort of thing. And he had this DVD burning process, and this was a very old Apple computer before OS X. It was sort of the old Mac operating system. And when he would put a DVD in to burn it, the whole machine would freeze for like 30 minutes. I'm serious, until the DVD finished. Because that DVD burning process just decided that nothing else was going to be able to run, right? Because it really needed, and who knows? I mean, maybe if it had let something else run, the DVD would have, you know, the DVD would have failed burning, because again, these early DVD burners weren't super awesome. But anyway, so it was like, he'd be like, okay, you know, I'm gonna go out for coffee, I'm gonna put in my DVD to burn, and again, like, nothing would pate, right? It just would sit there completely frozen. But it wasn't frozen, it was working. But you know, now that we've decided that we're gonna have this kernel and we're gonna put the kernel in charge, we need to figure out how to grant the kernel the powers and the privilege it needs in order to do this resource allocation, right? And the way that this happens fundamentally is that the processor, and this is one of those cases where the hardware is gonna play along, the processor creates what's called privileged mode, right? You know, modern processors support a variety of different modes, but fundamentally, for this class, you can think of there being two modes of execution. There is a privileged mode, or kernel mode, and there is an unprivileged mode. What makes these two things different? Like, what is that? Like, I can tell you that, but how does this actually work itself out on the processor? There's actually two things that being in privileged mode gives me two special abilities. What's one of them? One of them's kind of obvious. Yeah. Yeah, but how is that actually implemented? We're talking about a processor now, right? What does a processor do? Executes instructions, right? That's what it does. Instructions somehow manipulate the state of the machine. So being in privileged mode, one of the things that that means is what? What's that? Yeah, not really. Yeah, there are special instructions that can only be executed in privileged mode, right? These are, as directly as we can put it, these special powers that the operating system has, right? It is allowed to execute these particular instructions. We'll come back to why in a minute, or I should say how and why. But that's what it means, right? There are special instructions on the processor, and if you look at some of the documentation for your for the Sys161 simulator, you can find out what these are in MIPS. MIPS, like other architectures, has these special privilege instructions, right? And those instructions can do a variety of different things, right? They might manipulate parts of the processor that other things aren't allowed to manipulate. They might, you know, change the mappings for memory. There's all sorts of different things, right? And in many cases, I'll give this one away, when I'm also, the other thing that happens is when I'm running in privileged mode, I may also have a different view of memory than processes typically do, than an unprivileged process would. This is something we'll come back to when we talk more about virtual memory in about a month, right? All right, and so, yeah, so usually these instructions that are exposed to the kernel are somehow involved in, you know, somehow involved in sort of resource allocation or resource protection, right? They allow the kernel to manipulate parts of the system that either allocate or enforce resource allocation between processes. The CPU, you can think of the CPU as having like a switch, right? If the switch is in kernel mode, and we'll talk about how the switch gets to kernel mode, the whatever is running on the CPU, which hopefully is your operating system code and not something else, right, can access and run these instructions. When it's not in kernel mode, we'll talk about what happens if a, because a user program could certainly try to run one of these, right? What do you think would happen if a user program tried to run? What should happen?
Access denied.
Access denied, yeah, that's awesome. It throws an exception. This is the processor, we don't have these sort of things. Yeah, usually there's some sort of fault that's generated, and we'll talk about specifically how that works in a second, right? All right, so in order to sort of maintain the kernel's primacy on the system, one of the goals of operating systems is to make sure that only trusted kernel code is allowed to run in privileged mode. And user code is only ever run in unprivileged mode, right? That makes sure that the operating system is the only piece of software on the system that is special, right? The only piece that can manipulate these things, right? So just as a brief aside, it turns out that a lot of modern systems actually implement more than two modes, right? In fact, x86 family of processors has, I think, four what they call protection rings, right? So if I have multiple modes, what does that probably mean? So one mode, you know, we talked about kernel mode, mean that these special kernel instructions that I can execute. How will I implement multiple modes? Yeah, I mean, like one mode gives me access to some instructions, another mode to another set of instructions. The rings are intended to describe the fact that these modes are sort of supersets of each other, right? So in the full sort of, I'm trying to remember which one it is, ring zero, I can do anything, right? And in ring three, which is fully unprivileged, I can do nothing special. I can execute instructions, obviously. If I didn't let the process run, it would be a very interesting computer. And then the ring two and ring one give me access to sort of increasing amounts of power, right? And it turns out actually these are interesting and important today. They weren't actually used for decades, right? For decades, essentially, almost all the code that used the x86 processor only ran in ring three, untrusted user code, or ring zero, fully trusted kernel code. And then suddenly, when people started to talk about virtualization, these other rings started to make a comeback, right? And we'll talk about why at the very end of the semester. But anyway, for now, and for the mental model of the processor I want you to have for this class, you could think about it having two different modes, kernel mode, user mode. All right. So, and throughout the class, when I talked about an application or a process or a task, we're almost always talking about something running in user mode, right? And we talked about the kernel, talking about something running in kernel. All right, so the next, and again, what makes the kernel special is it's the only application allowed to execute in kernel mode. I think I've beaten this horse pretty close to death at this point, so let me go on. So here's an interesting question. You know, how and why did this one application on the system receive this special benediction, right? Like, why is it the operating system kernel, some kernel, right? Maybe it's Linux, maybe it's Windows, maybe it's Mach if you're running a Mac. How did this one piece of code get permission to run in kernel mode? How did that happen? Who's responsible for that? Yeah.
If it's the bus instruction that runs after the
dialogue. OK, so that's how. Let's come back to that in a second. But why? Right? You know, who has a laptop? Sumit, what kind of laptop is that?
Mac.
Yeah, why?
Would you give the company decided?
Okay, the company decided. Oh, man, we're just, you know, all hail Apple. You know, like, I couldn't do anything else with that computer. It's not true, actually. But who does this, right? I mean, did when the processor was made, did it boot up and be like, I'm an Apple? You know? when did this happen? What happened? But okay, they may have decided that like we're going to still put Mac OS on our Apple products, right? But and then what did they do? Or what did you do with? I'll give you a big hint. With like a DVD, you know, you installed it. Like this is your fault. Right? Most of you, right? I mean, some of you guys now have a choice. You could install something else if you wanted to. I'm not saying you guys should all be like, oh, no, man, my Apple laptop really now needs to be running Windows, because I think that would probably ruin at least a weekend of your life, if not a longer period of time. This is sort of what this means, right? To install a machine, to create a Windows machine or an Ubuntu machine or a Linux machine essentially means to take that piece of code and to put it on the machine in such a way that it is now the privileged application, right? It is the application that is installed. And as someone else pointed out, the way that this happens when you boot up your machine every time is what it means to install this. And there's, you know, you could probably give like 2 weeks worth of lectures on boot. And I'm not going to. This is just this little part of the slide. So this is quite complicated. But at some point in the boot process, your system will begin running your operating system, well, your operating system, the operating system kernel. And here's the important part. The privilege mode will be on, right? So when the machine boots up, at some point, the operating system will start to run. And it will be in privileged mode, right? And that's important because if you weren't in, so here's a question. Let's say that you booted up and it started running the operating system in unprivileged mode. What would be the problem? How do I get to privileged mode, right? Like, I'm supposed to be privileged. The same, the same barriers we're going to put up for processes to make sure that they are safe and can't access privileged mode whenever they want to would prevent the operating system from doing the same thing. Yeah, a question. So normally what happens is the operating system is loaded by the bootloader and placed in some particular part of memory. And at some point during boot, the CPU jumps to that part of memory with privilege mode on and starts executing instructions, right? And that is sort of the birth of the operating system. And in fact, maybe this is something we can do in recitation this week, you can see that those very first few instructions in your own OS/161 kernels, right? And you can actually find some of the code that loads them into the right place during boot, right? So at some point, so the kernel starts running. The kernel can do any sort of setup it needs to as it boots, right? But then at some point, before I execute a user process, I need to lower the privilege level, right? So that the user process starts executing in unprivileged, right? All right. So the next thing we're going to talk about is sort of how user processes get the attention of the kernel, right? Or how we enter the kernel, right? There's a couple of places where the kernel gets to run, right? The first time is clearly on boot, right? When I, you know, start executing the kernel, and the kernel does any sort of initialization. Again, it's just an application. It's like any other application. It's got some startup to do. It's got data structures to initialize. It's, you know, got some work to do. And that's why you sit there waiting while Windows draws that fancy animation over and over again. Or, you know, Mac sits there doing whatever it does, right? I mean, that's what happens when you boot the machine. But at some point later, as the machine continues to run, user programs will need to gain access to the kernel, or the kernel will need to run for other reasons, right? We call the process of sort of activating the kernel a trap, right? And we might talk, sometimes we talk about trapping into the kernel if you're a user process, right? You're running along, and at some point you generate a trap, and the kernel begins to execute, right? So when this happens, particularly when a user mode program is running and requests attention, what are some things? We've talked about a couple of things that user programs would do that would require the kernel's help. What's one example of something that would cause the kernel to begin to run on behalf of a user application? Yeah, fork. Dear operating system, please make a clone of me exactly like me, right? That's what it is. At that point, the operating system needs to run, right? You can kind of, and the mechanism is quite different, and we're going to talk about how this happens. You can kind of think of trapping into the kernel, making system calls, is almost like making a function call, right? In many ways, it's quite similar. It's a very well-defined interface. Each one of the system calls takes arguments and returns a return value, and then some other stuff happens. Right? So on some level, it's OK to think about the kernel as just another library that you're using. Right? On some level, it's also completely inaccurate, because the idea that the typical calling conventions that allow you to call functions in external libraries are not necessarily so don't stand up when we talk about the kernel. Right? You're welcome to think about the kernel as, again, sort of another function that you're allowed to call. Right? When you call it, there's some special things that happen. The kernel begins to run. When it finishes, it returns a value, right? But in reality, actually, there's a very, very specific mechanism for getting in and out of the kernel that we're going to start talking about right now, right? And you can sort of decide how you want to think about this. Both these ways are sort of effective tools to think about how applications use the kernel, right? So when we start executing in the kernel, there's usually three reasons. Right? These three reasons probably cover 98% of the cases, right? One of the reasons is that there's a hardware device that needs attention, needs to be taken care of. And because of the kernel's role in managing and multiplexing these devices, the kernel is typically the application or the program on the system that's in charge of dealing with things like, for example, what would be an example of a hardware device needing attention? Yeah, key gets pressed, hard disk finishes an operation, there's a packet that arrives on the networking stack, right? So these are examples of interrupts that so these are called hardware interrupts, right? These are the type of things that are generated by hardware. And at this point, we're going to allow the kernel to run so the kernel can decide what to do, right? Usually the kernel has to interact with the device in some way in order to sort of handle whatever condition the device is exposed, right? There's a second set of things, and again, we talked about some of these last week. These are sort of system calls. And we can call these, we call these either software interrupts or system calls. And it turns out that they actually use the same entry sort of mechanism as hardware interrupts. That's why we sometimes call them software interrupts, right? And then, so there's this final category of things. So one thing I could do is I could say, oh, you know, kernel, please help me with something. There's another category of things where software needs attention, right? So it's one thing to ask the kernel. When I ask the kernel, I usually know what I'm doing, right? I would like you to read from this file. However, it's also possible for the software that's running to be stopped because it needs attention, despite the fact that it never asked for it. What's sort of one obvious time where this might happen? Well, these are these are called exceptions. What's an example of an exception? What's something that a process could do that would probably generate an exception? What's that? Not necessarily. That's a little too high level. Segmentation fault is a form of this, but it's caused by something. Yeah. Yeah, I'm thinking of something from earlier in the lecture, though. What is something that would cause me that would cause the operating system to have to run and because? Yeah, or what else could I do? I could try to access a privilege instruction, right? These are all in the category of what we would call software exceptions, right? The difference between a software exception and a software interrupt is entirely that interrupts are sort of voluntary. They're generated by your code, right? You know, when you call fork, you know you're calling fork. When you access memory that the kernel might need to play with a little bit before it gives it to you, we'll talk about this when we talk about virtual memory, or when you mess up and you have some fault in your code that the kernel needs to handle, then we're in the software exception category, right? Those are not necessarily voluntary. They don't have to be bad. Some of them, actually, most software exceptions are completely healthy, right? But some of them can be negative, right? So, you know, again, so we talked about some of the examples of why hardware devices might need help. How is this actually implemented, like on the chip? You know, at the circuit level, right? We talk about interrupts. You know, how would, you know, I've got my networking card, it's over there somewhere on my circuit board. How does it actually notify the processor that it needs something? ESP, you know, what's that? What kind of a signal? What's that? Yeah, it's not even necessarily a register. What does it do? Yeah, a lot of times processors have what are called interrupt lines, right? An interrupt line is literally just a wire, right? It's the end of a wire, and when it's like a flag, you know, when the hardware device needs attention, it raises the flag, right? And the kernel is like, okay, I see you over there, right? I know that you have a packet or whatever, right? But these are sort of, and it's just a logic transition, right? It's like a zero or one, right? Like 0 volts, 3 volts, or whatever the processor runs, right? That's how these are actually implemented. So let's talk about what happens when an interrupt is triggered, right? And then we'll come back and sort of review the ways that we can get to this code, right? So remember, when an interrupt happens, the kernel is going to run. So when the kernel is running, in order to be special, what do I need? In order normally, in order to handle whatever caused the interrupt, what do I need to have? I need to have privilege, right? I need to be running in privileged mode, right? So when this interrupt comes in, and now this is stuff that's actually done by the processor, right? So this is how the processor allows the kernel to have these special powers while it's running, right? Remember, when I boot into the kernel, I've got my special privileges. However, as time goes on, I need to use my special powers to do stuff, right? So when something happens that the kernel needs to handle, the CPU will actually enter privilege mode. It will normally record some sort of information necessary to allow the kernel to figure out what happened, right? So it's like the kernel is like asleep, and suddenly it pokes. It gets poked, and it's like, you know, I need to do something, right? But how does it know what to do, right? It turns out there's usually some part of the CPU that it can look at and be like, oh, OK, that's what happened, right? Like, that's the device that needs attention. That's the software system call that this process is trying to do whatever, right? So there's some information I need to process the interrupt. And then here's an important part. It jumps to a specific memory location, right? This is hardwired by the CPU. When you lift that line on the interrupt line, the CPU just does this, right? This is just part of how the CPU works, right? You poke it there, and these things happen. And one of the things that happens is that it will immediately stop whatever it's doing and jump to this particular spot in memory. What code is located at this memory location? So this is called an interrupt handler, but what is it part of? What better it be part of? It better be part of the kernel, right? Like, this better be my code, right? My grammar is failing me. You have better had, I'm never going to get the sentence out. It was important that you wrote that code, right? There we go. Go with the passive voice. Because this is now executed in privilege mode, right? So because it's executed in privilege mode, it's part of the kernel. And the actual specific code that the kernel starts to execute is typically called an interrupt service routine, right? So here's a question. How do these little bits of code, and they can be large, usually the interrupt service routines themselves are fairly small. And usually what they do is they quite quickly jump into other parts of the kernel, right? So there's a specific memory location where these get loaded. And then you just execute a few instructions, and then you execute a jump, and then you end up getting into the kernel, deeper into the kernel code as you go to figure out what to do, right? Let me see where I have this. So OK, let's talk about this for a second. There are two types of hardware interrupts, right? Hardware interrupts can either be synchronous or asynchronous. The asynchronous interrupts generated by hardware cannot be ignored, right? And there's a type. So the synchronous ones clearly can be ignored, right? Asynchronous interrupts can be ignored, right? So there's a particular class of interrupts that the operating system is allowed to defer. And the way that's done is there are registers on the processor that can be manipulated by the kernel in order to tell the processor to not interrupt it when certain things happen, right? And this is usually called an interrupt mask. You can think of the interrupts as just a bunch of lines. They're just a bunch of numbers. And there's usually like a bit field that controls which interrupts are active and which ones are inactive. And while the kernel is running, sometimes it's very important that the kernel not be interrupted by another interrupt, right? So the kernel can choose to disable some of these interrupts. What do you think about the instructions used to enable the interrupt mask? Would those be privileged or unprivileged instructions?
Privileged.
Yeah, because if they were unprivileged, any process could just turn off all interrupts, right? And then bad things would happen, right, from that point on, basically. And the way that masks work is kind of important is that they don't make the interrupt go away. They just disable the interrupt service routine. So normally what happens is that this allows the operating system to just kind of say to the networking card, for example, just not right now, right? I'm busy with something else. I can see that you need help. And when I'm done doing this other thing, I'm going to come back to you, and I'm going to give you the attention you need, right? We're not going to talk too much about interrupt masks, but you'll see these used in OS 161 code sometimes, right? They're implemented, I think, in the simulator, but I'm not sure they're actually used at all. Some interrupts are impossible to mask, right? So for example, when you hit the power button, at some point, and now it seems like it doesn't happen immediately, right? But at some point, a unmaskable interrupt is sent, and essentially all that interrupt says is, by the way, I'm going to shut off, right? And you can sort of do whatever you want to do at this point, right? So there are some interrupts that have to be delivered under all circumstances, right? And again, the reason that I can mask interrupts is it's possible that I want to prioritize certain devices over others, right? What's an example of where I might want to do this, right? Why would I, who can come up with a little sort of case where one interrupt might be more important than another interrupt? How about this? So we'll go back to my DVD burner friend, right? You're burning a DVD, and the DVD device is trying to get your attention, saying, by the way, my buffer is almost empty, right? And what happens if the buffer empties while you're trying to do a write? You better have another DVD around, because that's just sort of the end of it, right? So in the meantime, the network's like, oh, hey, by the way, I've got some data here. And you're like, I don't care, right? Because if I don't get the DVD buffer full, it's possible that this whole process that I'm trying to complete is going to fail. Right? This is kind of a stupid example, but there are better examples of why I want to prioritize certain interrupts over others. One of the reasons for doing this in particular is that it's possible that the process of handling some interrupts, this is sort of like a little recursive, can generate other interrupts, right? And in that case, what could happen is I could end up in an endless loop, right? Whereas I generate one interrupt, I'm trying to process it, I generate another one, I jump into that one, and so I might actually never get finished, right? So sometimes I actually need to be able to ignore devices intentionally to prevent this from happening. All right, so we already talked about this. You know, if an application could we didn't talk about this. So the interrupt service routines themselves, right? So remember, when an interrupt happens, privileged mode, and I record some state, and I jump to a specific point in memory, right? And again, that point in memory is hardwired in the processor, right? It might be something that you can change, but you can think of it as just being a specific point that the processor and the operating system agree on, right? Like, this is where you're going to put the interrupt service routines. What would happen if I allowed an application to just overwrite them randomly? What would happen the next time there was an interrupt that was generated? It would run whenever you want it to run, right? And what wouldn't run there? The kernel, you know. And what privileges would your code be able to run with? Kernel privileges. So this would be bad, right? Yeah. And this can't happen. So these interrupt service routines are always stored in a part of memory that's prohibited, that user processes are prohibited to access, right? All right. Yeah, I think we've covered most of this. This point. And actually, if you look, so this is also true. One of the things that the kernel does during boot, remember, when you boot up the machine, the memory is full of junk. Might be zero, might be just random stuff, right? And one of the first things that the kernel does on boot is install these interrupt handlers. And that's important because until I install the interrupt handlers, I can't actually take an interrupt. And if you look at your OS 161 code, and this is something, again, I think the guru will go through in recitation, you can see the part where your kernel copies over the interrupt handlers to the locations that the processor is going to jump to when an interrupt happens. Right? This is one of the first things that the kernel does very, very early in boot. Right? All right, let me see where I am today. Let's see how far we're going to get. All right, so let's just start with software interrupts, and then we'll have to pause before we get to software exceptions, right? So because I've given the operating system the ability to manage the resources on the system, I need a way for processes to communicate with the operating system and request it to do things for them, right? I mean, we talk about the operating system having an interface, but like I said before, that interface is not implemented in the same way that you're used to with libraries and sort of other pieces of code, right? In particular, when I make a function call into the operating system, I don't push the arguments on my stack and start running some other code, right? I actually trap into the operating system using the same mechanism, right? So all CPUs provide some way of generating, and it basically you could think of this as generating an interrupt programmatically in your code. On MIPS, the instruction that's used is called syscall, right? Syscall is an instruction that user processes can access and can use. And all syscall does is basically just do the same thing that a hardware interrupt would have done, right? Who remembers what that is? What are the three things that happen when the interrupt line fires? I raise the privilege level to kernel, right? If it isn't already kernel privilege. I record some state on the processor necessary to help me process the interrupt, and I jump to the interrupt handler, right? So when software wants to the kernel to run on its behalf, it essentially reuses the same mechanism, right? And we will start here on Wednesday and finish software interrupts and exceptions.